webinar on the reinforcement detailing, which is a very important part of construction. Because without reinforcement detailing, we cannot do much. You know, until unless steel and concrete do not go together, nothing much can be achieved. So, for talking about reinforcement detailing, we have one of the renowned academicians from West Bengal, Dr. Debashish Bandyopadhyay, who is teaching at Jadavpur University. He is in fact professor, Department of Construction Engineering at Jadavpur University. He completed his BE from Jadavpur University, M.Tech Structural, and PhD from IIT Kharagpur. And he has also been awarded as National Fellowship in Earthquake Engineering Education. I mean, there cannot be any better person to talk about this. And as he was rightly saying, Jadavpur University is one of the well-known universities in the country where merit is being given much importance. And I am sure that academicians who are there and who are teaching at Jadavpur University, their concepts are very much clear, and with a very strong base of fundamental, I am sure that he would be able to throw more light on reinforcement detailing, which would be beneficial to all of us. So with that, because we had number of webinars in the recent past, we had two webinars on blended cement and one webinar on risk management. And there was a panel discussion also on the impact on construction industry. And today we had in the morning, we had a webinar on cracks and its prevention. So while discussing about cracks and its prevention, one of the most important thing that came during discussion was the importance of reinforcement detailing, which has to be done properly. Those were some of the thought process that we had. And let me again welcome Professor Debashish Bandyopadhyay, and over to you, sir. You can take the stage and you can go on with your presentation, and all are ready to listen to you. Thank you so much, sir, for sparing your time and to be here with us and to interact with all of us. Thank you. Please go on, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Karthikeyan.
My name is
thank Mr. Anirban Banerjee, who requested me to deliver this presentation. Good afternoon to everybody who have joined. Reinforcement detailing is not very new things. Everybody who are in the construction professionals, particularly at the site, they are well known about the fact. But there are a lot of revisions are coming, particularly considering the seismic aspect. And whatever he has told, that cracks in concrete, they are basically generating from the tension. Crack is very much related with the tension. And concrete, what is the meaning of concrete, is a very sound thing. You have concrete knowledge, I mean, it's very sound thing. So when concrete is very sound in compression atmosphere, it's almost like artificial stone, but it has a weakness in tension. And that is the reason why this composite material of RCC, reinforced cement concrete, came into being. Because there is a lot of compatibility between reinforcement and concrete, particularly the thermal expansion, bonding. Therefore, this reinforced concrete, cement concrete, become a very popular construction material for building bridges, infrastructure, everything. Now, the particular presentation is based on the provisions in IS 456, SP 34, and IS 13920, which is the ductile detailing. Now, there are different structural members: beam, columns, footings, stairs, slabs. So one by one we go. As Mr. Karthikeyan is telling, that cracks has been discussed in a detailed manner. But if we see, the top picture is for a beam supported on bricks. That means it is almost simply supported. So the main moments are coming at the mid-span, and there may be some type of flexural cracks. And when it is a continuous way, or it is a frame member, the beam is within the, is rigidly connected with the columns, then sometimes there may be some tension cracks at the support top, because the most of the negative moments occur at the support, at the top. Now, if we go for the fundamentals of bending moment diagram, so we know that hogging moments are coming at the support end and sagging moment at the Spain, which are responsible for the flexural cracks if we do not provide sufficient amount of reinforcement which will take care of the tension developed. So these are the two important things in a better way. Either flexural crack, what is discussed earlier slide, or the shear failure. Shear failure is pure shear, it is 45 degree angle cracks or diagonal cracks, but sometimes it is a combination of flexure and shear. So tension will result into cracks. Now who will take care, because concrete is weak in tension, therefore reinforcements are provided. So based on the bending moment diagram, at the tension side, if we draw, then the reinforcement requirement will be very clear. So in the first case, in the top picture, if we see that the main reinforcement should be at the span bottom, and for the flexure, this is the main reinforcement, and for the shear, which is inclined in crack, so the most of the reinforcement due to shear, that is the stirrups, should be placed at the support. Because if we think for a particular span, the bending moment will be like this. The maximum bending moment positive is here, maximum negative is here, and shear will be, for UDL, it will be like this. So most of the shear will be here and here. Therefore, the cracks may appear in this fashion. To protect those cracks, we have to provide the shear reinforcement. This beam is taken from a particular frame, so that this is the flexural type of cracks, this is the shear type of cracks. Now, as per our codal stipulations or practical understanding, we should provide the main reinforcement due to flexure at the midspan and tensile reinforcement at the support. But at least 50% of that reinforcement should be at the opposite side. So 50% of these should be here, and similarly 50% of this should be here, which is a common understanding in the field practice. But our codal stipulations are given, our stipulations are given in the SP34. If it is supported on the bricks, this is the brick pillar, this is a brick wall or brick pillar, then the main reinforcement, it is almost simply supported. Most of the moment will come here. The main reinforcement should be here, which should continue up to this end, that is 0.08 tensile, means 8% of the. Though there is requirement, but to confine the concrete, to make the lever up, reinforcement at the top. Continuous beam reinforced column sections. This is a column, this is another. And if we put the reinforcement, again, at the bottom, 100% rod should be provided. But as it is a frame, instead of a beam like supported on brick pillar, here there is a relaxation. You can go up to 0.15 L1. This is the clear span L1, this is the clear span L2. So we can go up to 15% of the span length from beyond which you can stop the main reinforcement, but minimum two rods or 30% of the AST maximum required at bottom should be provided. But when it is at the one end, then it has to be 0.1 L1. Here again, it is 0.15 L2, 100% rod at the main span. So this is the bottom reinforcement that is due to the flexure. Similarly, at the support, the maximum moment will occur at this top hogging moment. So in the code, it is given in three tire reinforcement detailing, but most often at the site, we go for two tire. So up to 0.25 L1, we provide the 100% rod, and beyond which 20% is the requirement, but at least two reinforcement must be there throughout. Similarly, this is also 0.25 L1, but please remember this 0.25 L2, they should be counted from the edge of the column. So So from center, it is almost like 0.3, but it, actually for it is support end. Reinforcement, they are very clear. You can optimize the reinforcement by theta. So up to 0.15, well, it is for one beyond that, it is for 20%. That in practice, it is very difficult. Most of the people go for 0.2, beyond which 20%, but not then reinforcement for the flexural requirement. You the most important structural members, particularly they are very much because there is no alternative load path. So type of structural members, and most of them at the bottom in support was moment is maximum, is trying to deflect. So there is a lot of tension. If we do not adequate reinforcement, crack may appear. What? So the recommendations for Indians are, if when which is connected to a cantilever beam, maximum moment, 50% of the length or LD. LD is the development length, which depends of concrete because the bond stress. So if we without ductile detailing, you can assume 50 times D. But when we go for ductile detailing, it should be plus 10 times D. So approximately, if this is the total span length, should provide 100% beyond V AST required for the maximum. In another report, you can see the casing is more closer at the support where it can it is much wider because maximum shear is close at the support. Similarly, for a tapered cantilever, we should hit the top by the similar fashion, but the top reinforcement should continue at least development to the other end. At the bottom, as it is not a mandatory for tension, so we can, if you the reversal of stresses is
there is some voice break. There is some, yes sir, sir, there is some voice breaking, I think some problem in the net, I believe some voice breaking is happening, audio some problem. If you can just look at the because you have been explaining about some continuous beam as well as cantilever, the reinforcement detailing, there has been some audio, you know, the it's not very
network audible. My network is still,
can you, what is it? Okay, I'm able to hear, but the voice is breaking actually. Can you just see your audio? Because you are visible, that means the net should be okay. Does the you're on the laptop? Because audio, there is some problem. Audio, there is some problem.
Still, okay. Problem is persisting.
Now it's okay. Now it's okay. Now it's okay. Sometimes the voice is breaking in between.
Network problem.
Okay.
But I'm discussing.
Okay.
The vertical dead load and live load. You can discontinue this thing. For seismic consideration, tension at this portion. So it is better to provide the reinforcement in compression also. Now, it is the normal nature of combination of flexural crack, predominant shear.
This is the curtailment rules for a cantilever beam.
Yeah, this was curtailment. This is the curtailment detailing of cantilever beam. Same the percent reinforcement.
Yeah.
At least one L.
Along with the development length rule. Development length, what does the development length for cantilever say?
Couldn't understand your.
The development length for cantilever beam. What does the provision say regarding development
length? No, LD is the development length, whether it is cantilever or any other structural members. LD depends on mainly either whether it is in tension or in compression, because the bond stress depends on either it is tension or compression. So bond stress, that has to be calculated, and it is approximately coming 50D. Because sigma s into phi by 4 tau bd is the development length. And if we consider the different permissible stresses for bonding, so normally if it is M25 grade of concrete, approximately 45 to 50 d you can provide.
All right.
So this is LD, and this is 0.5 L is the 50% length. That is the curtailment. You have to provide 100% reinforcement up to this level, and then 50%, that is the 0.5 AST. At the bottom, you can go for 0.25 time AST, but at least 2 bars should be provided.
Okay.
What I am discussing, these both this rod, if we are going to curtail, so this is one rod, another rod is going there. So this is continued up to development length at least in the next span. Development length means the development of bond. So if we do not provide 100% bond between the concrete and steel, then the moment carrying capacity may not be reaching to 100%. That means
what has been designed.
What we are assuming in our model, in numerical model, that it is a rigid joint, a partial rigid joint. So the is very, very important, because many times due to the lag, or some paranda, they are falling because there either maybe there are some corrosion of the reinforcement or inadequate development length, which will trigger for the premature failure. I am discussing that at the bottom, you can disconnect due to the, because it is a, this is not the, but considering the seismic consideration, one can continue this rod also. That will, during the reversal of stress.
So what it means is that reinforcement detailing is very important from the safety considerations as well.
Very, very important. You see, reinforcement the human body. So maximum.
Okay.
The compressive strength of the concrete is not going to play in 100% capacity. So it is not being properly, you can say, exploited. So reinforcement is very, very important, because whenever it is under flexure, flexure means moment, or shear, then reinforcement, the role of reinforcement is very important. The beam, the slabs, these are the they are subjected to transverse loading. So when there is transverse loading, there are moments. And when there is a moment, moment is nothing but it will result in one side tension, another side compression.
Okay.
So compression can be covered by then concrete if we do properly. But retention, there is no other way. You have to provide some reinforcement. Reinforcement means it is reinforced. So it is giving you additional strength against tension. That is the role of reinforcement.
Okay.
Hope I have answered your question.
It's clear.
This is the combination of shear and flexure. So shear is very, very important in concrete structure. Why? Because if a beam or a member is little bit deficient in flexural reinforcement, that is the tension reinforcement, there will be some crack, there will be some deformation, but the failure will not be sudden. It will be slow and slow. So the nature of flexural failure is ductile in nature, but shear is sudden. And that means it is almost brittle failure in totality. Okay. And in our earthquake consideration, we should avoid sudden collapse, sudden failure. Therefore, we have to be very, very cautious about the shear reinforcement. In practice, many a times we do not give proper attention to the stirrup detailing. Stirrups, reinforced stirrups are very, very important. So these are the provisions as per our IS 13920. Earlier it was 10 times the diameter, these rings, 135 degree hooks, 10 times diameter. In the latest 2016 revision, it is reduced to 6 times diameter to become much more feasible for construction practice. Because if it is, or minimum 75 was earlier, now it is 65. And there is a relaxation also, that one is 135 degree, another is 90 degree. That is provided in the latest revision to make some ease during the construction. So this knot type of reinforcement detailing is actually, when there is an earthquake, there is every possibility of denoting the bindings. And therefore the concrete become unconfined by the reinforcement. So to make the concrete in a confined manner, that means concrete has to be confined within the cage of shear and main reinforcement. That is the objective. Why? Because even if there are some cracks in the concrete is come out. Even if it is cracked, it should not come out from the during the shaking due to earthquake. So to make the concrete in confined within the reinforcement will provide the resistance against the earthquake shaking. That is the role. Why? That's why it is called confinement reinforcement. And code is provided that at least 2 times the depth, we have to provide very close stirrups, which will not only cater the shear strength, but also confine the concrete at the high shear zone area. So this 2D and this 2D at the both side, we have to provide the reinforcement confinement as per IS stipulations. And this is the IS stipulations, that this is the 2D, what I have already discussed, or it should not be less than D by 4 and 8 times DV, that is the hook spacing. But normally in the site, people are providing 75, that means 3 inch to 4 inch. So at in no cases, we should be allowed to provide the reinforcement more than 4 inch, that is 100 millimeter spacing, and 2 times depth. So if the depth of the beam is 500, then 1 meter and this side 1 meter, we have to provide whatever the reinforcement due to shear at the rate 3 inch to 4 inch as per IS stipulation to provide, but to ensure the ductile behavior of the beam during an earthquake.
So what is important is that the structure must not fail in shear, because it can be a brittle one, whereas a flexure failure will always be a ductile one. So we have to be very careful about the shear failure during seismic times, during an earthquake.
That is the reason a slogan was very much popular, that strong column, weak beam. Weak beam means intentionally when we are designing a structure, whatever the moment is coming at the beam, we should design it. But for column, we should make it little more safe. The reason is, if there is a failure of the beam, it will be local failure. At a particular portion, it will fail. But if a column is failing, then global failure of the building may trigger. This is number one. And second, what you have uttered, that there should not be any sudden failure. Sudden failure will lead to loss of life during the earthquake. In earthquake, as per IS 1893, there are two provisions. That means we are not going to design any building for the full earthquake force. We are designing for a very small fraction of force. If we provide ductile detailing, sometimes we go for only 1/10 of the earthquake force. So why it is telling that code is stipulating that you should design your structure linear way for that design basis earthquake force, that is 1/10 of the force, if we go by ductile detailing. But at the same time, the second thing is, it should not collapse even if the full force is coming into picture. So for maximum considered earthquake or maximum credible earthquake, this structure should not collapse. Now, how to prevent the collapse? Only providing ductile. The steel must be present there. In case of lap length, the code is stipulating that steel lap should not be more than 150, that means 6 inch. This is the provisions, the same thing. And the steel lap, we discussed earlier, it was 10 times diameter and should not. And these both should not degree. Way, the top one is commonly practiced because nobody wants any offset. So the size of the width of the beam and width of the column is same, and the reinforcements are doubled. Good one. Code we have to provide in the zone 3, zone column should not be less than 300. So if you provide detailing is a good practice. So because incline the diameter like this, a component will be in the, another component will be this direction, the four. If you want to find it, it should be very mild. It should not be sudden. So bit by this beam column. Totality, it should not be more than 6 inch. Here it should not be more than 4 inch. This is for the flange T beam or L beam. As per our codal stipulations, we have to provide L by 4 up to this in this direction and the opposite in addition to the width of the beam. This is for the deep beam. I am not going to discuss in a detailed manner because most of the buildings, deep beams are not being used. So when it is more
in
than
very special cases, only in very special cases and some special structures.
Cases, if we provide more than 750 millimeter depth, because then this beam becomes slender. The width is much less compared to the depth, then there is a chance of axial buckling. So to prevent that, some reinforcement has to be provided, size reinforcement. And the spacing should not be more than 300 millimeter at any case. In case of slabs, for a two-way type of slab, this is the, if we provide much more load, this is the way of 45 degree mostly yield line, based on the yield line theory, the cracks may appear in this type of, in this pattern. So to protect from this type of failure, IS code recommends, this is for the mid-span, and this type of cracks may appear at the end, is due to the hogging moment. So IS code stipulates the reinforcement detailing like this. You see here it is, instead, in case beam, we have noticed 0.25, but here it is 0.3 times L1 from the edge of the beam. This side also, similarly from this side. And if you provide cracked, then the cracking crank should be done not less than 0.15 L1. But nowadays, people are preferring for curtailment. So in case of curtailment, 100% reinforcement should be given up to 0.3 L1. People may go for three tier of reinforcement detailing, one up to 0.15 L1, another is 0.35 L1, where up to 0.3 L1, 50%, and up to 0.15 L1, 100% reinforcement can be done.
But one point is, in case we have to provide lap, where we should provide is one of the queries that is being asked.
Whether it is a beam or column or slab, any member, the lap should not be provided at a high shear zone or at a high moment zone. Normally, it depends on the type of loading. So if it is only uniformly distributed load, at the mid span, there will be much more moment. At the end, there will be much more shear. So better to go by 1/3 span. And another important thing, lap should not be provided for all the reinforcement at the same place. So it should be staggered. So you can provide in 1/3 and 2/3 in a staggered way. It is a very good question, because we from the university do a lot of failure analysis in the real life situation. I am not going to tell the actual sites, but we have seen simply lack of proper lapping, there are a lot of failures. So this is a very good question. Lap should not be provided at the high shear or high moment zone. That means you can, in general, you can provide at 1/3 and 2/3 span, and in a staggered manner at least. So every alternate can be lapped at the same place. So, but I prefer for slab, you can go by cranked. One bar should be cranked, second bar should go at the bottom, so 50% reinforcement is satisfied. Because if we provide the crank type of detailing slabs, that will act as a chair. So the requirement of additional reinforcement due to chair will be reduced. So that is one important. Secondly, this crank bar will provide some sort of shear strength in the slab, though in slab, shear is not a major thing. Mainly the flexure is the main thing. This is the stair. Code is also stipulated. There are three types of stair. If you provide the support at the end of the half landings or landings, then the total will be the span. If you provide the beam or support here and here, then the full, somebody can provide a beam here and here. So depending on the support condition, depending on the occurrence of hogging moment, the reinforcement detail will be followed. If you provide the steps by RCC, reinforcement concrete, then these are the housing reinforcement. You have to provide a rod here, here, and then it has to be connected by the vertical rods. But if you provide the brick stepping, then there no reinforcement is required, only at the top, because this will act as a load only.
Sir, one more query has come. Why nowadays straight bar reinforcement is used instead of bent up bar?
In case this is the slab where steel cranking or bent up bars is being practiced to a little extent, but in case of beam, people are not using bent up bars. The main problem is handling at the sides. Because if it is bent up bar, it is little bit difficult to put, and if there are some errors, it is difficult to adjust. But so the requirement of labors is much more if you follow the bent up detailing. Now, nowadays, the cost of material, if you consider the cost of material and cost of labor before 20 years back, now the cost of labor is increased in a much faster rate compared to the cost of material. Therefore, to avoid the much labor intensiveness and to avoid the handling problems, people are going for cartelment. That is the main reason.
Yeah, if I can rephrase it, it is just because of the labor cost as well as to avoid the handling issues. Many of them are going in for straight bar.
Time requirement will be a little bit more.
Correct. Okay.
That is the reason. I can give an example. In Calcutta, there are G plus 12 storied building are being constructed. Self-compacting concrete and total shear wall consideration. There is no beam, no column. The walls, and there is no brickwork also. But still, it is cheaper than the conventional frame and bricks. What is the reason? The main reason, cost of material is little bit more because you are providing cements, you are providing reinforcement, aggregates, everything. But the project time, completion time is reduced by 30%. So therefore, there is a lot of savings there. So ultimately, the total cost is the important thing. And if you provide with the advent of the self-compacting concrete, you do not require all those things for compaction, this thing, that thing. Concrete will flow like anything and it will complete in a very similar argument is for cartelment instead of bent up. So next portion is column, which is the backbone of any structure. Columns means even if always put this example to my undergraduate and students that even if a TT player, table tennis player, is going for a lot of exercise for his legs, though he is playing with the hands, but he requires a lot of strength in his legs. Correct. Why? Because until unless there is a proper balance, he will not going to play a good game. Yep. So similarly, columns are the main structural measures to make the structure stable, to make the structure balanced. Therefore, I recommend or I request everybody should to give much more importance to the column detailing. But unfortunately, we have seen that when we do a casting of the slabs, the main engineer will come, there will be some nariyal, phoda, mithai, everything will come into picture. Because maximum consumption of concrete, cement, reinforcement will be in that day. But when there is a column casting, nobody is there. Even the main masson may not be there. Only a helper is doing with lot of water cement ratio. And by simply a rod or bamboo, he is compacting. Correct. But this is totally contrary to the requirement. Column should be much more. So therefore, even if the building is designed for M20 or 25, go for column at least one grade higher. Go for greater strength.
I agree with you, sir. I agree with you on this point because during our interaction also with many projects, we have seen that a lot of importance is given to slab concreting. Whereas when it comes to column concreting, it is being done by hand mixing itself. There is no machine mixing also involved in that. So that is another big problem as far as the
because the consumption is much less. We are governed by the requirement, consumption, everything. Nobody is taking cubes in many a cases. So column should be given utmost care. You give some incentive to the machines. Make the column better, I will give you 20% extra wage. Yeah. That should be the idea. Otherwise, it is very difficult to maintain the quality of columns. But my request is that care should be taken much more in column. Similarly, for the detailings, these are the common three types of failures in columns, either by inadequate moment or shear or axial strength. So to address those lacuna, code is given that for circular columns, at least six number of reinforcement must be there, minimum six number of bars. for rectangular columns 4, but if rectangular or square, but if it is a very much rectangular, say 250 by 750, then the column should be designed that the reinforcement to reinforcement distance should not be more than 300, like in deep beam or any other case. So there should not be any reinforcement more than 1 foot distance. Similarly, these column ties, they have two objectives. One is confinement. And even if the column is not subjected to any moment, purely axial column, you have to provide the stirrups. Why? Like stiffeners. So these are the reinforcement. So if we do not provide these stirrups due to axial load, the reinforcement may got buckled. So to make it stiffen, reinforcement in the ties, that is the shear reinforcement, should be provided. It will provide little bit shear and strength due to the horizontal force. It will provide confinement of the column, and as well as it will provide stiffening effect to the main reinforcement. These are the different types of ties. You can put a total square tie and another tie in between, or even if you can, this type of tie, one tie, this tie, and a tie, or you can go by even this type of, like this. This is not shown here. Rhombus type of. So it depends on what is the requirement of the reinforcement, what is the size, what diameter you are providing. But whatever is provided in the drawing, please go through the drawings in details and please read the notes in any drawing. Sometimes what is happening, people are providing some very crucial information at the notes. So follow those things in a very stringent manner, particularly for the columns. Ductile detailing requirements. Again, 135 degree hook, 65 millimeter or 6D hooking that is required. This is another important thing, is when you go for a construction joint, because which is very common, whether it's a column or beam, you put the tie reinforcement or stirrups just 50 millimeter, that means 2 inch below the construction joint. And again, when you are recasting, you give another additional stirrups 50 millimeter, so that at the joint portion, the shear strength must be adequate. In addition, you should provide a construction key, that means provide better bonding strength. If it is not possible, put some double bars so that it will transfer the load from the one segment to the another segment of any construction joints. Stipulations in the IS codes, where this is the earlier requirement, 10 times diameter and 75, now it is 65. These are the continuity of the reinforcement from one floor to another floor. So when there is a beam, like slow inclination is allowed, and then it should provide a development length at this top level, and another reinforcement should come. So this is one way. And when the top column size is reduced, which is quite common for a high-rise structure, so lower column say maybe 400, upper column is 300. So what is happening? You should provide the reinforcement should stop here, the reinforcement should stop here. You should start a new reinforcement here and there, but you have to provide the double bars, which should continue from one joint, one LD, and from here to another one LD. And that confinement reinforcement has to be tied with the stirrups. That is the, otherwise, if we consider it is a monolithic structure, the moment, shear, everything will transfer. That will not going to take place until unless we provide a proper reinforcement detail. This is the ductile detailing in a pictorial manner. Again, this is HC by 4. HC is the clear height, 1/4, and this is 1/4, in which at least 8x6 should be very closely reinforced.
Should not... This one query, sir. One question has been asked. If we can interrupt you here, in earthquake design, details of reinforcement in column beam junction, it is mandatory to have stirrups for columns. But practically, it is observed that it is not happening as the beam reinforcement is tied and lowered on column. It is practically becoming difficult to implement when we take the reinforcement of beam and column.
This is also a very good practical question. Many a times I came across this question. I am coming to that. I think this picture will clear Fine. Much better way.
Fine.
You see, this is a beam and this is column. Earlier days, we provide the shear reinforcement this portion and beam stirrups in this portion, but we never provide this stirrup reinforcement in between the beam column joint. What any revision of code is resultant from the research. Now in research, beam column joints, if it is subjected to earthquake shaking, then what happens? These concrete, after certain cycle of force, the concrete in between the beam column joints will got cracked. And when the concrete got cracked, there are every possibility of disintegration of those concrete.
Okay.
And at one time, what will happen? There will be no concrete, only the reinforcements are there, which are not tied. And then if the earthquake force is still coming into picture, then there will be some kinking. Kinking means sudden collapse of the beam column joint, because there is only reinforcement, there is no concrete. So code has given this reinforcement, because this reinforcement has no role of providing any shear strength. It is only confining the concrete during earthquake shaking. Even if the concrete got cracked, but if we provide this reinforcement, then the joint will behave more like a joint, a three-dimensional joint. It will not kink. So it has a much more energy absorption capability during earthquake. So that is the reason. Second part of the question is, it is very, very difficult in practice. That is true, I agree. So what to do? As it is very requirement. Now you see, now there is a disaster, COVID-19. It is very difficult to confine ourselves in the home for a long time. But we have to do, because this is the requirement. But there should be some solution. What is the solution? Like essential commodity, government has relaxed something. Similarly, what we can do, we have to cast the concrete up to this column level. And then when you go for this casting of the beam and slab, we should provide a rich and much workable concrete with greater workability. First put at those column beam column joints, say self-compacting type concrete, and then go for the rest of the concrete. So this joint, you give some admixture, you give some more workable, pumpable concrete, which may not require any vibration, or you can put some vibrator. But you have to provide this type of reinforcement to ensure better performance during an earthquake, particularly for zone 3, 4, 5. This is mandatory.
Okay. Thank you.
I the rest, I have already discussed that this should be greater than 8x6 transverse reinforcement again at the lap joints. It should be very closely stirrupped, this portion and that portion, and these beam joints, everywhere we should provide closer reinforcement. The things are given in a very lucid way in the IS 13920. This is another typical beam column joint details. They have not considered the confinement, but if problem of providing LD, then you can provide additional dowel bars by this manner. What we have seen in the column to column, you can also provide beam to beam. Because if the moment is much more, we have to give much more tensile capacity to resist the movement. IS 13920, this is also a very practical problem. Sometimes what is happening, somebody is casting up to this level. Mm-hmm. Now you see, you have to provide the top reinforcement at LD. And in case of earthquake ductile detailing, it should be LD plus 10D. That means if LD is 45D, you have to provide 55D. Now, this rod you can put easily in the top level because you have, you are going to cast this column later on. Okay. But you have already casted this column. So if you do not provide this development length at prior, then it is very difficult to provide the LD. So what you will do? This is the case. The portion of the top bar below the soffit of the beam is very difficult to provide. So if you provide much wider column, then the LD is this length plus this length. So if we provide a wider column, then this length may be adequate to provide the LD plus 10D. But if it is a very narrow column, then you have to provide the rod earlier during this casting. So solution, either you have to provide the extra top, that is a not extra top, that is the LD at the beam column joints at prior, or you have to provide wider column to accommodate the LD within that.
There is one more query they have asked. What is the intensity of earthquake in Richter scale? Can this kind of RCC design withstand?
You see, scale and intensity, they are totally different. Okay. Richter scale is a scale to measure the magnitude of earthquake. Okay. Magnitude means how big the earthquake in terms of energy released. Mm-hmm. Charles Richter, he is the first person to measure it. Therefore, Richter scale is so popular. Still, it is being practiced. So Richter scales, and it is in log scale. So in 6 Richter scale and 7 Richter scale, it is almost 31 times in terms of energy release. So 6 to 7 and 6 to 8 is almost 1,000 times. So there is a huge in terms of energy. But to the civil engineers, to the structural engineers, Richter scale is not so much important like geologists. We are much more interested on the effect of an earthquake, which is measured by the intensity. And that is being measured by MMI scale, that is called Modified Marshall Intensity Scale. So question, if I understand, that these ductile detailing, for how much intensity it is required, it is advised. You see, earthquake intensity or earthquake magnitude at a particular place is very, very uncertain. You do not know in coming 50 years what type of earthquake can come. So that is called another subject called seismic hazard analysis, microzonation, macrozonation. There are a lot of things. But what is provided, that there are 4 zones right now, zone 2, 3, 4, 5. And zone 3, 4, and 5, you have to consider 3, 4, 5 very in detail right now as per IS 1893, 2016. And zone 2, beyond 15 meter height, that means 5 story, you have to consider in the same way. So only if you are situating in zone 2 and your structure is less than 15 meter, then you a little bit relaxed like green zone. But everything is right now is under red zone. So in red zone, this type of reinforcement is very, very helpful. And code is also giving you some incentive. What incentive? If you provide the ductile detailing in this manner, you are allowed to design your structure for 1/10 of the earthquake force instead of 1/6. So you are getting additional 60% benefit. So So force is being is drastically reduced from 1/6 to 1/10. So if the it is 60 kilonewton is the force for which you have to design. So you may design by 36 ton. So that is the advantage if you go for this type of ductile detailing. See, maybe 10% additional reinforcement is required, but your main reinforcement may reduce to 15%. So in sometimes you may gain, and in addition you will gain that if the earthquake, because normally we are designing for a design basis earthquake, which is much more, less amount of earthquake force. But if there is a huge earthquake, which is very uncertain, is going to come. And in that case, if you provide this ductile detailing, your structure may got cracked, your structure may got damaged, but your structure will not collapse. So people will be survived. And that is the motto of our earthquake resistant structure.
Ductile failure is what you are looking at in case of a failure.
Ductile detailing and collapse preventing. This is called state of collapse preventing. So I will recommend, or code is recommending, not me, that we should follow ductile detailing to the extent possible. It will reduce the reinforcement required in many cases. It may not reduce to that extent, but no doubt it will ensure much more greater safety to your structure.
All right.
Because in Bhuj earthquake, after that Bhuj earthquake, I became very much interested under the guidance of Professor SK Jain, Sudhir Jain. There I went there, I have seen a lot of failure of structure. And you see, earthquake is a natural event, but the seismic disaster is not natural, because our structure is not properly designed or constructed due to the seismic demand. So it's a man-made disaster. Because there is no casualty for the apes or the monkeys, but lot of people died. Because we are staying in a man-made structure which is incompatible to the earthquake requirement. So we must provide the ductile detail to prevent the sudden collapse of a structure. For footings is nothing but invert slab. Whatever the loads is coming through the columns, from slab to beams, beam to columns, columns to lower levels, and finally in the footings. And the footing is giving like our feet. Why the feet is so wide in our legs? Because if there is no food, there is every possibility that during our walking, our legs may punch the soil. So therefore, to reduce the effective pressure on the soil, footings are being provided. Now, in case of our civil engineering, we should consider the free body diagram. So whenever you are putting some load from the column through footing on the soil, the soil is giving some reaction upward direction to maintain the equation of equilibrium of forces. And those forces are nothing but giving different moments and shears to the slabs. And so it is designed basically as a slab, but inverted slab. Load is coming from bottom to top, not top to bottom. So considering that fact, you have to, it is isolated footing. So when it is isolated footing, that is a cantilever. So maximum moment here. So you have to provide the reinforcement like this direction. This is cross section. So main reinforcement is in this direction, because when the forces are coming from bottom, so main moment is there. Therefore, the depth is required at this end. You can reduce some amount of concrete by notching like this. Because okay, maximum depth required based on the moment developed due to the soil pressure at this junction. So that is the requirement. You can provide a pedestal if the column is very big and the many and huge force is coming. Then pedestal will save some amount of concrete in the footing, because punching shear will be much less. In footing, there are three things. One is moment, one is normal shear, one diagonal shear, another is two-way shear or punching shear. So if the force is much more, then if we provide a pedestal, That means from column, so then there is a notch offset that will give you much better load distribution as well as less depth of the footing. So concrete requirement will be less.
So why shear reinforcement is avoided in case of isolated footings? Any reason for that? One of the questions that
are. Because this is a slab. In case of slab, we never provide normally any shear reinforcement in normal cases. In some footings, we are providing shear reinforcement for a very special case. But normally, as footing is nothing but a slab. So therefore, the main reinforcement contribution towards the shear and the depth, because tau is force divided by BD. So if we increase the D, the tau will be reduced. And if tau is less than the tau permissible, tau means shear stress, so tau permissible is a function of the main reinforcement. So reinforcement and depth, this depth, they will take care of the shear. We normally do not provide any shear reinforcement for slab and so forth.
What about in rectangular footing? Is the main reinforcement in which direction is it provided? Is it in the larger or the smaller direction?
You see, whenever if it is a rectangle or square or whatever, square is in the both direction, it is same. So you can provide in any direction.
Rectangular
one will be the main reinforcement, another will be the distributor, but they are of the same dimension for a square. But in case of rectangle, it depends on the overhang portion. The overhang portion in both direction, normally what is happening in the shorter direction, the overhang is much more. So in that direction, moment will be maximum. And that will take care by the reinforcement in that direction. But if you do not provide any beam between the two columns in the other direction, then there may be some alterations. So that has to be checked when I think this is the combined footing.
Mm-hmm.
Rectangular. Oh, you are asking for a rectangular footing.
Rectangular footing.
For a single column, if you provide rectangular footing, then the dimension that is the much greater projection, that will give maximum moment, and so that direction the main reinforcement will be there. But in case of combined footing, I am telling that on the other end, that will be, you have to provide a beam like this. Now, as per IS 13920, you have to provide again this confinement stirrups, which was absent in earlier cases. So this is also a difficulty in providing. You have to give with much more workable concrete, because when there is earthquake, this column is subjected to reversal of stress, and then there will be crack, there will be chances of concrete getting out. So it has to be confined in the same argument that is for beam column joint.
What about eccentric footing?
Eccentric footing is required when there is a shortage of land. You can't go beyond certain landmark or something. Or there is some movement in addition to the axial force. The objective of footing design is that the CG of footing and the CG of force, if it is coinciding, that should be the ideal case. Because we do not want moment in the footing. So if the CG of the force is coinciding with the CG of the footing, then there will be no additional moment on the, and therefore there will be uniform force distribution below the footing at the soil. Otherwise, P by A plus M by Z. So in one area, it will be much more pressure. In another area, it will be less pressure. So there will be some sort of tilting, or there will be some sort of settlement may arise. So to avoid that situation, the objective to go for eccentric footing by making that the CG of the footing and CG of the force must coincide. And then if it is an eccentric footing, the footing is subjected to uniformly distributed load from the soil. So then the design will be same like other type of footings.
What about the steel quality or the type of steel for resisting earthquakes, sir? that should be used in such cases? Any specific?
Initially, I thought that I will include also in the presentation.
But just in one or two sentence, if you can say, what should be the quality of steel?
You see, if you, whenever you are handling with some material, we should know little bit about that. Initially, we are using mild steel, and mild steel is a much low energy level material. So just from the iron ore, it becomes mild steel. Mild steel has the strength of Fe 250. That means its strength is 250 megapascal. Now it is becoming tor steel, Fe 415 grade. That means the strength is almost 60% increased. Why? By just using the technology of rope. If a rope is just twisted, the rope can take much more load.
Okay.
But at the same time, the rope become much more rigid. The ductility has reduced. So nothing is free in this world. When you are converting mild steel to tor steel,
yeah,
you are sacrificing the ductility. So then after the lot of people are asking for ductility. So then the TMT, that is the mechanically treated reinforcement, is the present reinforcement, where actually what is happening, depending on the process of steel quenching, etc., there are several state of metallurgical state. So outside it is martensite, and inside it is austenite and ferrite. So austenite and ferrite is a ductile material, whereas the martensite tempered with the outer core is much more strong. So it is providing the strength, inside providing the ductility. It's the combined of these things. Now, when you are using those things, people are using D, that is the ductile. Say Fe 500, Fe 500D. So Fe 500D has a greater ductility. And I, for the ceramic zone, particularly 3-4, and when you are going for ductile detailing, we should use Fe 500D because the cost for Fe 500 and 500D is almost equal. So why not we will go for Fe 500D? It is better to use the steel from a renowned steel maker, those who are making the steel from zero to end product. There are so many organizations who are taking some material from somebody and then making the steel. I am not against of them, but there are much more possibility that the quality of that material is not controlled to that extent which is required for a good ductile material.
Okay. Sir, what about this weak beam strong column theory? Is there any theory like that? As you were mentioning, the column must be strong.
Already mentioned.
Okay, that is, yeah,
that means the bodybuilders, if you have a very strong shoulder, strong arms, but have a very poor legs, their balance is much less. But even if a bodybuilder who have a very good arms as well as legs, he is no doubt the best. But if the leg is much strong, that man has a greater balance. Now, I have already mentioned that the failure of beam is a local, it's a localized zone, but the failure of columns may trigger for a global total structural failure. So to avoid that failure, always go for strong column, weak beam, because during the earthquake, we do not want that the plastic hinge will come in the column. It may come in the beam for a local problem, but we do not want yielding of the column, that is the plus development of plastic hinge at the column. So to avoid the failure of column, we should go much more factor of safety much for column, that is stronger beam in compared to stronger column in compared to beam. So it's a relative term.
You already repeated that.
More stronger compared to the beam at a joint.
So that is the reason. Correct. We got that, sir, because you have repeated this again the second time and it was very clear. Now, the second thing is that when we provide opening in beams for pipeline and sewage, what should be the reinforcement consideration in that case, whenever an opening is provided?
Whenever there is opening you are providing, if it is a square or circular, whatever may be, then at the periphery, you have to provide a additional reinforcement. Therefore, at the cutting edge, there are stress concentration, sudden jumping of stress. To take care of that, you have to provide peripheral concealed beam type. You have to provide a peripheral reinforcement. And particularly at the rectangular or square opening, at the corners, there will be much more stress concentration. From both sides, it is coming. So at that edge, you have to provide additional 45 degree angle reinforcement to take care of the cracks. Like, in case of circular, that is not a problem. So only peripheral reinforcement along that cutting, you have to provide the reinforcement.
Okay. Now we are coming to the strip footing, no, under column, if we can just talk about
the strip footing is a very good option for a seismic zone, because that will give you a much better box action at the tie level, beam level, at the footing level, and it will also resist the differential settlement problem. Even if something is settling, trying to settle, because the soil is may not be a good one, the other footing will take care and the force will transfer through this strip. So that means it is acting as a joint family instead of nuclear family. So strip footing is a better option when the soil characteristics is, because where I am staying, this is a place called Salt Lake in Calcutta. Earlier it was a lake, and then the Dutch people technology, the sedimentation from the Ganga is being deposited at this land and the new land developed. But as it was a lake, so beyond 1.5 meter or 2 meter depth, there is a very, very poor quality of soil. Bottom of the lake, that soil is very, very clay type there. It has almost no strength. So there is a possibility of settlement and other things. So it is a compulsory practice in this area. Even if you go for my house is two-storied building, we have provided a strip footing. And strip footing will give much better option to address the problem of differential settlement.
Okay.
Combined footing, trapezoidal footing. Tell me.
Now, how much more time will you take, sir? Because we have already exceeded the time limit. How many more slides are there?
Oh, acha. After this, I think not very.
Okay.
Very much. I think 10-15 minutes maximum.
Yeah. Fine.
Will you? There is a problem.
No, it's not a problem. Please go on, sir.
Okay. Now, when there is a problem of there are two columns, one column big, another column small. So CG will be here, but the total length is constant. Other land, there is another land. So what you have to put the CG of the footing and the CG of the force must coincide. I have already told you. So if there is a say 100 ton, this is 50 ton. So CG will be much closer to the stronger, bigger column. So to accommodate that, I can go either this way, the footing length is much more, but that is not possible due to the constraint of land. So what is happening? We can increase the width here. So that means it is becoming a trapezoidal. So the CG of the trapezoidal should coincide with the CG of the force. So that is the requirement for combined footing, trapezoidal footing. And then it is simply like normal combined footing. You have to provide both directional reinforcement according to the moment developed due to the soil pressure. This is the section. Now, this is the actual practice. People are telling that it is very difficult to go for ductile detailing. This is a picture from the Newtown area. There is a lot of use of these actual very close 7-3 inch distance stirrup spacing. If it is not clear, but even the beam column, there are reinforcements, shear reinforcements are there. And only the problem is you have to make pumpable concrete, at least more than 150 millimeter slump concrete has to be provided. Otherwise, there will be a lot of honeycombs. In one way, you are providing ductile detailing. In another way, the concrete is weak. So again, there is a problem. So the compatibility between the concrete and steel must be ensured to get the desired performance. So I think this, thank you very much. I'm not going to extend any longer.
Thank you so much, sir, for sharing the information. In fact, you have almost shared with us and you have clarified most of the queries that the participants have given. And if there are any more queries, we'll email it to you and you can just look at it. So it was a good, great presentation with a lot of interaction. Thank you so much for your time. And Dr. Debashish Bandyopadhyay from Jadavpur University has taken off his time to speak to us, and myself, Anil Kumar Pillai from the Ramco Cements, I take it as my
privilege. You are Mr. Pillai. I thought you were Mr. Kartiko, and because the name host is
the host. So it is a privilege to have you, sir, and you have taken off your time. In fact, we have a series of webinars in the next few days on modern construction practices, on smart cities, and on more of the general topics of construction. Because for the next few days, we have continuously up to May 3rd, webinars are there. And we would also be sharing the questions which the participants would be asking. So as far as Ramco Cement is concerned, we have been propagating this concept of right product for right application. In fact, we have different types of cement brands. We have almost 12 brands of cement, which is being used for different applications. That is 4 types of PPC is there. And then we have 4 types of ordinary Portland cement. It is, of course, fulfilling the BIS regulation, but looking at the concrete requirements, we are recommending the type of cement. So that is a new initiative we at Ramco Cement has been taking. And we believed that it is a holistic approach. You know, concrete is a holistic thing, because when you talk about RCC, reinforcement detailing as well as concrete, both are equally important. Because at the end of the day, we want our customers to be happy and they should be building durable concrete structures. So that is our objective as an organization. So with those few words, I would like to thank our IT team, who has been taking a lot of pains. Mr. Karthikeyan, whose words you are mentioning, he has been taking a lot of pains in ensuring that the IT for this thing platform is all right, because in these days, I think if the IT platform is good enough, we would be able to connect with each other. And I would also like to thank all the participants and the attendees who have taken off time to be here and to interact with us. So with those few words, I thank you, sir, and thank you all the participants. Have a good day and take care.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, sir.